Alright, so hi everyone, my name is Philipp Dominik Schubert and I welcome you to the C++ programming course, which is offered by our research group called Nowadays Secure Software Engineering. So last time we still have been software engineering, but this year the group has been renamed to better reflect what we actually do. So we are now called Secure Software Engineering. Yeah, I welcome you to this lecture. So let's just get started, I would say. Okay, so you're sitting here in this course to learn the C++ programming language. I guess that that is what's happening right here. And to give you a warning up front, so it's going to be very easy to learn C++. So I mean, it's similar to Java and Python, so what can go wrong? So C++ is easy. It's like riding a bike, except the bike is actually on fire and you are on fire and everything is on fire in fact, because you are in hell. And this is basically what C++ programming is, at least from time to time. It can be that terrible, but it can also be great fun. So, but do be prepared that, I mean, C++ is not like Java or not like Python or any of those other languages. It can be quite hard at the beginning, but be patient. I will give you a lot of tips and hints, and let's hope we can all make that work for you and also for me, of course. So maybe one more thing, a junior C++ developer, so C++ can bite you relatively quickly. So if you try to do something, if you try to program a thing, a small task, and then the fork jumps right into your face. If you are a more experienced, professional, senior C++ developer, the picture would actually look a bit different. That would be more like it. So you do some fancy tricks, of course, because you almost master the language. But in terms of C++, I would say you never really master the language. But at the very end, sometimes it can still happen that the fork jumps right in your face, and that's just how it is. So it probably builds character. So it's also, you can see this course as kind of a character building course as well. So, and you get that one for free, right? Okay, let's get a bit more serious now here. What are the contents of today's lecture? So in the beginning, of course, we will talk about the organizational matter. So times, places, most likely it will all be online, right? Due to the current situation. We will talk about the course outline. So what can you expect? What I'm going to teach you here? What are the various topics we have a look at? And then today we will talk about the history of C++ very briefly. Then we are going to talk about C++ compilers. You actually need compilers in order to get a C++ program running on your machine, and we will have a look at what compilers actually are and how they can be used. And we also are going to write our first program, which is called a Hello World program. So usually if you start learning a new programming language, the first thing that you do in that very new language, you write a Hello World program. So that is just a program that prints Hello World to the command line, really. Then we talk about how to set up a development environment. So what kind of environment can you prepare for yourself such that you are able to actually write some code, compile it, getting it to run and do something useful. And at the very end, we will talk about some basic terms and concepts of C++. We will talk a bit about data encoding, and we will already get a hang of variables. We will mention variables. What are variables? How can they be used? And we will then pick that up in the next lecture next week. All right. So let's talk about the organizational stuff. So, I mean, you already see my face to the left, but that's also a picture of me, an older one. And how is this lecture going to be organized? So, of course, it will be a full online course. So we don't really have rooms, physical rooms. What we do have instead is we have this very lecture here. I record those lectures usually sometimes on Friday in the morning because I can't find a better time in my calendar. And I'll upload the lectures recording in the university's Panda system, and also I will upload it on YouTube. So we now, in the Secure Software Engineering Research Group, we also have a new YouTube channel, and I'll upload the lectures there as well. And I'll try to do my best to make those lecture recordings available on Friday till 14, such that you can really stick to a schedule. So, I mean, even in those strange times we find ourselves in nowadays, it's probably very important to have a more or less strict schedule. And so I try to help such that you can stick to a schedule to get some routines going on to make everything work out. And of course, the recordings, okay, I can tell you anything and you can't complain, you can't ask questions. That is a bit unfortunate. And that's why for the exercise classes, we actually implement them as a live stream. We already did that last year as well. And it worked quite well, really. And we do some live streams on Twitch also on Fridays from 16 to 18. So we will have some live streams, and in those live streams, what we usually do is I'll present to you the current exercise sheet, and I'll then present the solutions, or sometimes even multiple solutions, because in C++ usually you have a gazillion ways of achieving a task, and I'll present some solutions, and also you can then, of course, using the live chat, ask me questions. And I'll pick them up from the chat and answer them. So that will be a bit more of an interactive format. This is currently the room. My office would be in that very line here. I just changed it, so because I'm sitting at home, right? So I live in Bielefeld, so it's nearby Paderborn, the city that doesn't exist. Haha. If you do have any questions, you can contact me by mail. So this is my email address. Don't complain if I don't respond in a few hours or a few days even. So I get, unfortunately, tons of emails, and I'll try to answer them as quickly as possible, but I also need to get some research done and all other things. So it might take a while. Be patient. I do not forget about emails, so I just have to work my way through. If you have particular questions to this course or even contents of this course, rather than sending me an email where only you ask the question and only you get the answer, please make use of the forum in Panda. We have a Q&A forum in the university's Panda system for the course page. And please ask your questions there. And usually there are also no stupid questions, so feel free to ask what you don't know or would like to have clarified. And that way, other students, first of all, can see, okay, there are some other guys who also have the same questions. And other students can also then see my answer, or even your colleagues are, of course, if they know the answer, they are free to answer as well and also help me out, of course, a bit. That will make things much more convenient, I guess. And we also do have a web page here providing additional information. This is the link. You can also find exercise sheets and all that good stuff on this web page here. So what do you need to know in order to attend this course? I would say no to little programming experience is required. So we'll teach from scratch, but also that implies that we move a bit faster than maybe in other courses, because C++ is a huge language, and I can't, of course, give you all the details in all the different areas of that language. But I will basically give you kind of a roundhouse kick, so an overview on everything. And if you are interested in how the details work, you can look it up yourself. But I prepared you, at least that's what I'm aiming for. I'll try to prepare you to look things up, or to be able to look things up and to get the details on your own. So you need to know how to use a computer, of course. You need to be able to manage a text editor, because we need to edit some source code, which is pretty much always done using text files and not Word documents. Sometimes I get also some hand-ins where program code is written in Word documents. That doesn't work out very well most of the time. And of course, you should be able to use a computer's operating system. Yeah, right, that's what we usually do. Linux, Windows, Mac, I don't know. So one of those will be fine, pretty much, I guess. What else? Maybe let me tell you a few words about myself, just if you're interested in it. Otherwise, you can just skip that part. So I studied bioinformatics and genome research at Bielefeld University a few years ago by now. Oh dear, it has been a long time. And then I wanted to do my PhD. And for that, I was more interested in the actual computer science informatics parts of bioinformatics. And for that reason, I completely switched fields and accepted a position at Eric Borden's Secure Software Engineering Group in software engineering. So it's basically pretty much hardcore plain software engineering. I in particular work on static program analysis, or program analysis in general. So what is program analysis? Basically, it's we write programs that analyze other programs in order to find bugs, security vulnerabilities, and undesired behavior, and all that kind of stuff. That's what I'm doing. And Eric is also responsible for a part of the Fraunhofer team, which is why our research group spans over the Heinz-Nixdorf Institute and also the Fraunhofer IEM. And in order to not get bored, because I have so little things to do, that's a joke, by the way, but I still got something on my own going on nowadays. And yeah, it's a bit stressful, but quite fun. So quite fun. Okay. So what are the benefits of taking this course here? I mean, there must be something in for you, otherwise you would not and probably should not take this course. So what are the benefits for you? You can be very confident to be able to take advanced courses that require C++. So usually, I don't know if you have it in Paderborn University, but in Bielefeld we had computer graphics and those hardcore courses as well. Lots of maths, and you also had to implement that stuff somehow, and the language of choice for obvious reasons, which will become clear after this lecture, is the obvious choice is C++, and that's why for those courses you typically need C++. Realize programming projects. Yeah, you can then work on your own programming projects, implement your own programs. It will also be useful for what is called computational thinking. So if you have a task and you wish to solve it in a strategic manner, I mean, we as humans, we just solve it. We don't really think about it, but that's not how it works in computers, right? So you have to give a computer precise instructions, what needs to be done, what needs exactly to be done in order to solve a given task, right? There's no space for uncertainty, usually. And that's also one benefit, I would say. Better understanding of how a computer works, yeah, because C++ is a programming language that gives you full control of all of your system's resources. So you will be able to tell at the end of this course what is memory, what is main memory, what is cache, why the hard drive is slow, even if it's SSD or whatnot. You will know about how files work, file handles, all that stuff. So you will also, in general, improve on your understanding of how a computer works. And of course, at some point, we all have to make a living after our studies, or even, I mean, while we're doing studies, even though our living is a bit on the low end, but at some point, we wish to get higher and well-paid jobs, and C++ is usually typically one way of getting a well-paid job. We will come to that at the very end of the lecture, where I show you how to get a well-paid C++ job. So, money, of course. And also, in addition, this is a university, so the university pays me to do all that kind of stuff, right? Also, of course, to do some research, but also teaching. And you get this offer for free, right? So you can just consume this course and get the knowledge and learn about all that stuff. And later on in your professional career, there are, of course, also consultants and experts who teach you that kind of stuff. But typically, they also need to gain some money, of course, like everybody does. And typically, if you wish to attend to a C++ masterclass, for instance, it's basically over just one weekend, and you pay 2,500 per person. So for those consultants, quite a good job opportunity as well. But typically, it gets more expensive later on. So if you can have something for free, I would say that's also a good benefit, right? One more thing about the Studium Generale. So this course is kind of categorized in the Studium Generale. What does it mean? That unfortunately means that computer science students will not be able to receive credit points. So for computer science students, this is a pure optional offer. Nevertheless, that being said, most of our attendees are computer science students, which is probably a suitable thing. Electrical engineering students will also not be allowed to receive credit points. So, sorry, you guys. Also optional offer. Whoopsie. But all other students should be able to receive 4 credit points for this course. And if you're not sure about that, please ask your examination officer. They'll tell you if you don't know yourself. Exactly, so you receive 4 credit points. And at the very end, if you could successfully manage this course, everyone will receive a nice certificate stating what we have done in this course and that you successfully managed this course. And it's just a nice to have for your CV, and if you wish to apply for a job later on, that never hurts, I guess. Okay. So, what else? Some of you who are watching this recording are probably not yet registered yet. This is just a reminder to please register to this course in Panda. Because using Panda, we will also going to do the hand-ins. So for the weekly exercise sheets, you have to put the hand-in in Panda, submit via Panda. And also I will distribute some additional materials. So here's the ID, the link with the course ID. Please register if you have not already done that. We'll also have some external students, which is why I upload that on YouTube. And for the external students, if you're watching that as an outsider, basically, here's a link where you can find most of the materials at least. And yes, so really, I mean, since I put all these slides online, sometimes I get some emails from Greece or from all countries, many different countries, stating like, yeah, thank you for the materials. I'm a JavaScript programmer and I wanted to learn C++. And I mean, this makes me happy, of course. And it really shows that also a kind of outsiders, non-Paderborn University people are watching this course and consuming the materials, which is great, I guess. And also one thing is, this year we are over 200 students, so that's the most we ever had. And Yeah, let's hope we can manage to grade all your exercise sheets. That's really a bit astonishing. So let's see if we can manage. We do have some student assistants who help with grading the sheets, and let's hope that we can that we'll make it worked out. Okay, and I got some reviews on the last year's version of the course, and I'll try to improve at least. So we'll now have even more C++. I crossed out some topics which are not that relevant, not that interesting, and we will have a few changes compared to last year's version of this course, hopefully for the better. At least that's what I planned. So this course this year in 2021 with even more C++. So it will be great fun. All right, let's talk about the course outline. What are we are going to deal with here? So that's pretty much what we are doing today. Basic introduction. So we will talk about the history of C and C++. Just if you're interested in that, we make it brief, so no worries. We will talk about compilers and why you need a C++ compiler eventually. We'll talk about development environments, basic terms and concepts, so pretty much all the basic stuff that you need in order to start at all. And then over the next few lectures, we will talk about basic C++ programming. We will talk about data types, expressions, statements. How can you actually encode a computational task? How can you encode something for the computer that the computer can actually run on its CPU or GPU even? We're talking about structures, unions, enumerations, functions, classes, all that good stuff that you have in C++. That will be new material. So I'll also get into more detail on how to organize a C++ project. We will talk about C++ related tooling that can be quite helpful, namespaces, forward declarations, you name it. C++ template library, which provides I/O, input/output functionalities, containers or things you can put and store data in. Talking about static dynamic memory, memory allocation, smart pointers, and also, of course, the advanced technologies or techniques that C++ offers, copy control, standard class members, operator overloading, object orientation. We're also talking about that. And of course, since we do have C++, we will be talking about templates and generic programming. Also, I'll present to you in one lecture useful libraries. So one lecture will be dedicated to present a bunch of libraries that could be useful to you eventually. So I'm not going to into detail here right now, but I will also present some useful libraries that can help you with certain tasks to accomplish certain tasks. And yeah, you can just look it up whenever you need it later on. And yeah, where you can find the desired information once you need it. One point being here, don't reinvent the wheel. So if some guy already implemented or provides an implementation for an algorithm that allows you to achieve a certain task, why would you do that all over again, right? I mean, this is not very smart, not very good, just waste of time and also error prone. So you should rather use libraries which are hopefully well debugged and have been proven to be useful. That's the idea. In terms of literature, so besides consuming those lecture recordings here, what else can you have a look at? There's probably this little book here, which is called Tour of C++ by Bjarne Straustrup, so the creator of C++. And that's really about 120 pages. You can read it over a rainy weekend, so should be able to manage to really go through that relatively quickly. That can also be a thought here of the course's script. So don't ask me for a script, just get this book and read it. That's pretty much the script for this course. If you need to, kind of need to have some material which is even a bit more low level and starts with more of the fundamentals, you can also get this book here, Programming Principles and Practice Using C++, also by Bjarne Straustrup. This would be the C++ programming language, would be the C++ Holy Bible, but it's over 1,000 pages, so I only ever use it to look up details, if you ever need those details here. This is an interesting web page here, CPP reference. You will hopefully use that page frequently, because whenever we are using some library functions from the standard template library that comes with C++, and you wish to look up how certain data types or functionalities are being used or need to be used, you can all read it up on this web page here. There's also a YouTube channel called CPPCon, that's a C++ conference, and you will find additional great talks about various interesting topics on the YouTube channel, which you can also have a look at. Then there's some other book, Effective Modern C++, that's pretty much more on the advanced side, but if you might wish to have a look at it, if you feel otherwise bored in this course here. And there's also some other online tutorial, you name it. And what is very important, that not only holds for this particular lecture, but also for anything that you really wish to learn and try to master, so you need various different input channels, such that your brain gets the optimal, mixture of it all. So it's important, of course, to attend to the lectures. Also, if possible, attend to the exercise classes, if you can manage in terms of time. I'll try to make some links to books and also YouTube videos, and I do advise you to have a look at those additional materials in order to kind of deepen your knowledge, get another point of view on a certain thing, to get it all into your head, basically. So you need some different input channels. That's very important. And what's also very important is that you talk to each other, of course, and look things up that you're interested in. So if you and a colleague of you are wondering, why does that particular construct work, or how does it work, then it makes sense to look those things up and also to communicate and to tell your friend or colleague who also studies this course, of course. Don't tell anybody else, because they will think you are a maniac, but that's what I would advise you, at least. This course will have some accompanying exercises. So there will be weekly exercises comprising theoretical and practical exercises. And the submissions are graded. So you need to solve the exercise sheet and submit it via the Pandas system. So there will be a hand-in, and you need to achieve 50% during the semester, like overall. So it doesn't matter if you don't hand in one exercise sheet because you have been too busy doing other things. I would not recommend doing that, skipping exercise sheets, but that's the way it is. And what's important is that you have 50% overall that you need to achieve. And once you have achieved 50%, you are admitted to the final project, and at the very end, so there will be a final project, a programming project, which requires you to solve a bit more of a demanding programming task. It's not too scary, so you can think of it as an extended exercise sheet. And if you really did all the previous exercise sheets in that course, you can solve that final project over a week, and if you spend the complete time and not doing other stuff as well. And at the very end, you will get that certificate I just mentioned if you pass the exercise classes, so those 50%, and if you successfully have been able to solve the final project. There won't be exam. So there's no final exam. It's just exercise sheets and final project. Please do not copy solutions from other students. So that is prohibited. And we will also apply some software which works quite well in detecting plagiarism. So don't do that, because otherwise you will be awarded 0 point, and if you do it repeatedly, you will also be reported to the university's administration. That's a place where you don't wish to be, I would assume at least. So please don't even do it. What you are of course are free to do is, if you, I mean, it's the real world, like in a job later on, you can also use everything that you have, right? So if you have a task and if you can't figure out for yourself, or you are interested in how it can be done better or solved better, you are of course free to use books, to use Google, to scan the entire internet to get that solution done and working. That's perfectly legal here. But I don't want to you to copy solutions from other people. So if you use external sources, clearly mark those sources and also state the source where you got some material, ideas and codes. All right, that would be what I would like you to do. And also adhere to the notes on the exercise sheets. Because we are now over 200 students studying this course. If everybody does in a slightly different manner, then it's really a pain to grade and correct those exercise sheets. So please adhere to the notes on the exercise sheet. Questions so far, haha, funny me. So you can't ask questions at this point in time, but what you can use is, you can use the Q&A in the Panda system. So please ask your questions in Panda and I'll try to answer as soon as possible. All right, so that has been the course outline and all the organizational matter. Now let's talk about the history of C++, and before we get into the really interesting stuff here. So why should I ever learn C++? Because we already talked about it, well-paid jobs. Once you really got the hang of it, it is quite fun to develop in C++ programming language. And also we still have a high demand for C++. So this is an updated slide with the most recent data. And you can see C++ is here. So that's the TOB programming community index, by the way. What they do is they collect a bunch of data that can be mined on the internet and kind of crunch it all down to come up with a number, and the number indicates basically how great the demand for a certain programming language is, right? And C++ is here at rank 4 today, and the last years, I mean, it's pretty much stable here at place 4 currently. All-time high is again C since 2019 again. So it is now position 1. And what do you have in between? You have some Java and some Python, pretty much same level. Of course, what you wish to know about is a programming language that is in high demand and where you have people. But you also, you don't want to be the biggest community, because then, I mean, everybody is able to program in Java, then the Java developer jobs are not paid that well, right? So you want to be somewhere in the middle ground, which C pretty much is here. So it's a good combination, I would say. So what is a C++? There are many terms that you could use to characterize C++, and here I've written down a few, because I've written them down, but I stole them from this talk here. And how could you characterize C++? So first of all, it's an object-oriented programming language. Certainly true. So you can use it as an object-oriented programming language, but you don't have to. And this pretty much holds for all the terms here. So it can be that, if you make it that, if you use it like that, but it doesn't have to be. it allows for generic programming, yes. Template meta programming, certainly. Buffer overflows, yes. because it allows you to access the details of your machine. And if you fiddle around with the computer's machine's details, then there's also a chance that you make mistakes and then you end up in buffer overflows. C++ allows you to define classes. Other people would say it's too big because it has too many features. Some people would say it's a host for domain-specific languages. So what does that mean? So you use C++ to develop your own domain-specific language in C++. So it's also a bit of a crazy idea, but it is used. A hybrid language. It's often used in embedded systems and low level because, yeah, why? Because whenever you have some hard restrictions in terms of performance, so you must be that fast to have your software function at all, or you must fit into that amount of memory, you must get your computation into that amount of memory, otherwise you won't be able to ship your software or whatnot. C++ is the guy for that. That's the programming language for those kind of stuff because it gives you as a developer the full control over your system's resources, and you can really use it the ever whatever way you need it really. So some people would call it a random collection of features, probably coming from the Java guys, and you also have to know that there's always a bit of a language war, so the Java guys versus the C++ guys and the other way around. So one community is always making fun of the other community. That's that's pretty much how it works. You can build class hierarchies. We'll also learn about that. Multi-paradigms, yeah, sure. A failed attempt to build Java, I wouldn't agree with that. It's C. It's definitely not the C language, so C++ is its own language. It's still compatible to C though, but you should really treat it as another language. It's not C. And you should not implement in C or program in C++ as if you were programming in C, because that really leads to terrible code. Too complicated, so some people say it's expert friendly. And yeah, that might be true. That's one of the reasons why you get so much money later on. But if you have the patience and if you keep on it, you will manage. You can manage, of course. So don't be too afraid here. And yeah, that's a different slide I integrated. I won't explain that. Look it up on your own. I just skip it for now. So what is my advice to become a professional C++ developer? First of all, don't be afraid. So you can learn all those things. Rule number one, learning a new language takes time. You can't expect to learn C++ in like 2 months and then you are the perfect, it takes years. I mean, of course, till the level where you can actually do something, that's achievable in this course, of course, and in the final project you are of course solving a more complex task, but not too kind of difficult. But really, to become a senior software engineer, so really like an absolute pro, that just takes time and experience, and you need to make mistakes and you need to learn from those mistakes in order to make progress. That's just how it is. So practice. That is what I can tell you. You have to read a lot. That also complies with my point being you need to have multiple different input channels. So also look up the A Tour of C++ book, for instance. Also read code, also other people's code. Read code from senior C++ developers who know how to write good code, and then you can imitate their style and improve on your own style. Do the exercises, of course. Even if you have achieved 50%, it would still be a very good idea to solve all the exercise sheets, even if you already achieve 50%, just to get the hang of it, to also learn about the more advanced concepts. And always ask yourself, why does it work? So in C++, in the programming language, there are language constructs which look so archaic, so brutal, you think, yeah, how can that ever work? But it works and it gets the job done. And this will happen a lot of times here in this particular language. So ask yourself, why does it work? How has this been implemented? And if you're really interested in something, yeah, look it up. Use Google, discuss with friends how that works. And once you understood it, it will be really fun as well. That I can tell you. Even it's sometimes a bit stressful, but really most of the time it's great fun doing that. So how did we end up with C++? So what is the history of C++? So it all started with a language called BCPL, Basic Combined Programming Language. And it has been used to implement the very first computers, the very first machines. It has no data types and it turned out to be somewhat usable, but people wanted to have something better. In the very early days, what you did is you have a custom machine and you implemented custom software which runs on this machine. And then if you have a new machine, you implemented new software for that particular machine. And really, that's terrible, right? That's pretty much inefficient, and pretty much the definition of inefficient, because you need to start all over again for each new machine or architecture or whatnot. And the idea really was, can we build a programming language that is so powerful that allows you to implement entire operating system in that very language? Because the benefits of that would be you implement an operating system in a certain language, and then you can just translate that piece of software for each architecture, and you need to do only some minor changes to get it working on a new architecture. And but the idea was to reduce the repetitive task. And B has been invented. That was one attempt to get a language done that allows you to implement operating systems, and it failed. It was not quite powerful enough. But then you do know what comes after B. After B comes, of course, C. It has been improved on and was better than B. And C was a huge success. In C, C is the language to implement operating systems in. That worked out really, really well. And so a huge success. And it has been mainly developed by Brian Kernighan and Dennis Ritchie. Those are the guys on the left-hand side, on the right-hand side here, respectively. And so great work, really great work. And then at some point, Mr. Bjarne Straustrup came along and he had the idea, C is a bit, too low level. No, maybe that was his view on things. I don't know. But anyhow, what he did is he started extending C. Object orientation came into, came trending, you would say today. So, and he extended C and came up with something which was called C with classes. Computer scientists being as uncreative as they can be. So naming variables, naming things is always the hardest problem in computer science. So he came up with C with classes, which was a terrible name, of course. And so later on, you ended up with C++. Exactly. So, and it's of course dynamically evolving. So we have various standards, and I'll try to teach you here the more recent standards. So C++ 14, 17, and C++ 20. And there are so those standards really provide some great language improvements. And by the way, just to give you a hint, so C, the C language, is almost 50 years old, and C++ is almost 40 years old. So really old languages, but still used, more than ever even. So on the TOBI index, you saw that C is now wieder, is now at again as at its all-time high. And also C++ is used, and by using the modern standards here, it has become really nice to implement and program in C++. Why are we not directly learning C++ 20 then? I cannot teach you 5 courses in one. That's probably the best answer. C++ 20 introduced so many new features, also with the other standards 14 and 17. I try to teach you the good overall modern styles, but I can't give you all the details. I can't present to you all of the existing language features. I show you how to use the most important ones, and then you can look up the rest for yourself as needed. Because it's just a huge language and we only have so much time, so I have to make it fit in one course. Other reason being, adaption needs time, so usually you come up with concepts and ideas first, then you have some compilers implementing those concepts. Then you have nothing for a few years, and then industry usually adapts 5 to 10 years later, and you might wonder, yeah, why is that? I mean, industry should try to pick up things as soon as possible, and yeah, they are trying their best, and but there are reasons for that as well. So first of all, the concepts have to be proven useful, and compilers also have to mature over time to get all the bugs sorted out, because compilers are also pieces of software, and software usually has bugs, right? And those need to be sorted out. Okay, so we have BCPL, we have B, we have the C language, and why don't we call it just D after C, right? That would be the more reasonable thing to do. C was and still is tremendously successful, and lots of existing code was and is even still written in C today. And the reason being is, don't break compatibility. So one of the number one goals of C++ was not to break compatibility with that much software which runs in the world, C, implemented in C. So, and don't break compatibility, and rather be an increment than a completely new language. That is the reason being, and that's also that reflects in that name C++, right? Being an increment. But we still do have a language called D, and it now gets more popular even. It's used by companies like Deutsche Bahn, for instance, and there are also some other companies who have a community. In that area here, but D is no longer compatible with C. It's no longer compatible. Be aware, however, that modern C++ is definitely not C, and you should really treat it as its own language, which is compatible, of course. You can be completely compatible, but it's still a different style, right? Okay. That was the history of C++. Now let's talk about C++ compilers, which we need in order to get things done here in this course. What is a compiler? The most basic view that you can have on a compiler is the following. A compiler is a box. And when I say it's a box, it's also a piece of software. So it's a program. So a compiler is a program which takes as an input a source program, and it compiles it into some other target program. And in this course, and usually most of the time, the source program is usually your C++ source program in human readable text file format. And you give that text file containing your C++ code to the compiler, and the compiler then compiles it down into a binary version of that program, which can then be executed by the machine directly, which can be executed by the machine's processor. That's the idea. And then, of course, you have a separate step, because once you have your target program, which is in most cases some executable binary program which can run on your machine again, this program usually run to do something, right? You wish to have a task accomplished, right? And so you have your executable program, your target program, and you give it some inputs. It can be some data that needs to be processed, and then your program runs on that data and it processes it according to whatever you have written. And then it produces some output, right? Which are your final results most of the time, or maybe it can also be some intermediate results, which are then handed over to another program. But that's the most basic view, right? You have a source program, you compile it into a target program, and then you can run that target program on some input data in order to produce some output data. That's how it's done. And now you can ask yourself the question, are there other forms too? And the answer is yes, there are. So there is not only compilers, but also you can have an interpreter. So what is called an interpreter? What is an interpreter? An interpreter is also a piece of software. It's also a program which takes in your source code. So for instance, some Python code, let's say you have some Python code going on, also a text file or whatnot. And it takes that Python code in text as a text file, and it takes some input it should run that program on in one step, basically. And then the interpreter goes ahead. What does it do? It reads the program, and it executes the instructions on the input data as it goes through the program. So it reads the program, translates the program to binary, such that can actually be executed on the CPU, and then it runs that instruction on the input data in order to produce output data. So it's basically all pretty much on the fly, which is also one of the reasons why compiled languages are typically run much faster, right? Because if you can compile your program up front and then you only have to run it, that's probably faster than translating your program into machine code on the fly while running it on some data, right? But in using an interpreter, it you would do both, basically, both at once. And there's even more. There is, of course, something which is called hybrid compilers, and that would be your traditional Java ecosystem setup, where you have both, basically. So in Java, for instance, you have your source files written in Java, hopefully. And you translate it using a compiler, which does not produce machine code, executable machine code, but it will rather produce some intermediate representation of that program, some intermediate program. And that intermediate program is then run on some inputs on what is called a virtual machine, and also the translator and also the virtual machine boxes are still software, right? So, and that would be your Java compiler, this one here, and that would be your Java virtual machine, which runs your Java bytecode on some input in order to produce some output. And not only Java works this way, but also C#, and I don't know, maybe there are even more ecosystems that implement that approach, but that's the basic idea. And now we talked about C++ or compilers in general, but now we need some actual C++ compilers in order to to be able to work with C++. So what's going on here? What can we use? So I present to you, there are of course way more C++ compiler implementations, but two of the most famous ones are the GCC compiler, the GNU compiler collection. It's a compiler infrastructure which includes front ends for C and C++, so basically C and C++ compilers. It's also the standard on most Linux distributions still, although Clang is catching up quite a bit. We'll talk about that in a second. And there was this claim, I don't know if it's still true, maybe, most used C++ compiler in the world. So it really is quite widespread, the GCC compiler for C and C++. First stable release was in 1988, so quite old by now. It is basically one giant monolithic design. they try to improve on that a little bit, at least that's what I'm hoping for. and it has been developed by something which is called bootstrapping. Because if you don't have a C, C++ compiler, you can't, you can't pretty much use that programming language, right? If you don't have an implementation. So what bootstrapping means here is that you write a piece of software, so namely here this GCC compiler, that has been written by something else until it has become powerful enough to compile itself at some point, right? Does it make sense? You can also look it up, bootstrapping. Maybe on the internet they have some better ideas how to explain that in a better way. But that's at least the idea. And then there's the Clang compiler, which is part of the LLVM project. And it also comprises language front ends for C and C++, also Objective-C and all those C family languages. And it's heavily used by Google, Apple, Oracle, so many of the major companies use Clang, and the LLVM infrastructure has been developed by Chris Lettner as a PhD thesis. At least that's where it started, and then it picked off like crazy, so other large companies invested engineering efforts to make that project work and to help making it grow. And yeah, nowadays it's really a production quality compiler which is used a lot because it's part of a reusable compiler infrastructure. Great thing if you have the right problem for that. And there are of course a lot more, like Intel has its own compiler implementation for C, C++ and all the other major companies as well. But here in this course we stick with those two, GCC and Clang. And actually, if you now open up the box a bit that we had on the one of the last slides here, the compiler box, it just was one block. that was actually a bit of a lie, or it was, too much of an abstraction. So a compiler is not only one box, but rather it is, compilers are, the C++ compilers are language processing systems, which comprise many, many more steps. So first of all, C++ is usually a compiled language. And C++ compilers, as I said, are language processing systems, sometimes also called compiler tool chains, because it's not only the compiler itself, but it's also a bunch of additional tools that you need to make it all work out. And that would be a nice figure here of the of what a language processing system actually is. So at the beginning, you start with your basic source programs. That's the programs that you and I just write. And we will also have an example on that on the next few slides and in the very end. And first of all, that source program is not directly given to the compiler to compile it to binary, but rather it's first pre-processed. So in a C++ compiler, there is a step which is called pre-processing, and there's a tool called the preprocessor, and the preprocessor reads your source program, your original source program, and modifies it in order to obtain a modified version of your source program. And then only this modified source program is handed over to the compiler, which compiles your program also not directly to binary, but it compiles your program to target assembler for the target architecture that you're planning to run your program on. So what you're producing is assembly code. And then this assembly code is assembled by a tool which is called the assembler, which then produces machine code, right? And then there's one more step, at least on this high level view, which is fair enough and good enough for this course, I would say. Finally, you then have a linker which links your machine code that has been compiled from your original source program, and it links it to some libraries or to some other pieces of code that you or your colleagues have written or whatnot in order to produce the final target machine code, the final executable binary. So that is basically a language processing system, which every C, C++ compiler represents. Multiple steps. Okay, and now let's really get started. Or let's get started slowly, I don't know. So remark on what follows. Keep simple things simple as possible, but not simpler. Who said that? Albert Einstein, of course. And you may ask, yeah, why can't we just have it as simple as possible? The problem is learning a new programming language is a hard task, of course. And at the very beginning, it will all seem like magic. But you have to bear with me, right? So please don't be frightened. Don't be scared. Don't run away. Work on it. So it seems all like magic, but magic that works eventually. And yeah, in order to be able to start at all, you have to take certain things for granted and learn the why over time. Because if you explain this detail, then you need to explain this detail in order to understand that detail for which you need this detail, and you wouldn't be able to start at all. So at the beginning, you have to take that certain things are the way they are. And you will learn the why that is and why that has to be in the remainder of this course. I think that is probably the best strategy to get started. All right, then let's start writing our first Hello World program. So why a Hello World program? What is it? What is a Hello World program? So the idea being, if you learn a new programming language, the idea being is write a Hello World program that prints Hello World on the command line. And usually, once you have written your Hello World program, you have still learned a lot about the language you wish to learn, because you need to adhere to some certain syntax, then you have some semantics, how you express things, how you organize your code, you get a feel for a programming language's look pretty much, and you start understanding stuff. So that's why whenever you learn a new programming language, the first thing that you usually do is you write a Hello World program. Okay, let's do that. The shortest valid C++ program is the following. So int main, parentheses, and then braces return 0, semicolon. That's the shortest valid C++ program. However, of course, yeah, the compiler is smart enough. You could even just make it in main and without the return 0, semicolon. The compiler would still generate the correct code. That is the shortest program. And what does the program do? What does this program do? Nothing. So you can really edit a text file, just edit the contents as follows, in main return 0 or just in main, and then you can translate that into a binary using a C++ compiler implementation like GCC or Clang to obtain an executable binary, and then you can run that binary on your machine. And what does it do? It starts the program, and then it immediately exits because there is nothing else to do. There are no instructions really given. It just starts your program and immediately exits your program. That's what this program does. Then let's write a Hello World program, which does at least a bit more. That would be a Hello World program here. And it prints Hello World to the command line. So let's go through this line by line and again learn why that is over time. So first of all, with that hash include, you use a header file, and this hash include is actually not even an instruction for the compiler. This hash include directive, it's called a directive, is a directive for the preprocessor. And preprocessor is one of the steps, as I explained on the language processing system slide, right? So this is for the preprocessor. What else do we have? Then we have a comment. So because code can be complex, you can write comments. and what's the use? Why should I use write comments? Comments help you and your colleagues to understand what your code does. Sometimes code can be really complex looking, and in order to remind yourself and others what this code is at least supposed to do, you can write a comment, and you introduce a comment line by using //, /// and then you can read then you can write a line, and until the next line, this line will be considered a comment. And what effects does a comment have on my program? None. So a comment is completely ignored by the compiler. It's just for humans, right? Then you have a main. A main is a function. Main is in this case it's a function. In the case here below, it even has some arguments. So you can think of a function in terms of programming in a way like you think about mathematical functions, right? In maths, you can also have a function which takes some input parameters and then it does some stuff to produce some output parameters, basically. And the same thing holds here. So you have a function which can also take some arguments. So in this case, it takes an integer argument and a char star star. We will learn later what that is. And yeah, the function's name is just main. And main is a very special function because the name main for a function is reserved. So whenever you have a piece of software, you can only have one function that is called main. And this main function is special because this is the program's entry point. So when your compiler compiles your program to executable machine code, and if you then run that executable machine code, main will be the function that is being called for you by the operating system. So this is the program's entry point. And then in main, you can do whatever you would like to do. Then it's all yours, so to say. We also use a namespace here in that little piece of code. And we are using the namespace std. So std is called or is a namespace. And then we use a scope operator, this colon colon here, stut colon colon. We use that namespace and the scope operator to use the variable cout. Cout is a variable, it's an output stream variable. Then we are using the left shift operator, that is this angular left bracket and angular left bracket. That's a shift operator. Then we are using a string literal. So in those quotation marks here, this is a string literal, basically just a piece of text. And we basically, what that means is here, please take this piece of text and shove it into the output stream to print it to the command line when the program is run. That's the idea. And then what you have to do at the very end of main, so at the very end of main basically is where your program is finished, so to say. So once your program is done, because it did all the instructions that it found in main, and then it hits return zero at the very end. And this value here, the zero, is a value that is returned to the operating system. And if you return a zero, that indicates to the operating system, hey, this program ran successfully. And values other than zero indicate failure, basically. That's how you can think of it. Okay, so what you could do now, as I already mentioned, you could edit a text file with the following contents. And then you, of course, need to tell the compiler, hey, compiler, please translate my hello.cpp. That's the file I named like that. Usually you give your file a name and then you have an ending.cpp that indicates, hey, in this file, there's C++ code. That's convention. And you tell the compiler to translate that into some executable machine code. How do you do that? You call your compiler, cc, if a variable for your C++ compiler. Hello.cpp, so you give it the file name with those contents here. You give it an additional parameter. So this dash o stands for output. And here you just specify that the output file should be named hello. And then after you have executed that compiler command, you will have an additional file which goes by the name of hello, which you can then run. That is your executable binary program. And on Unix, Linux systems, you can run that program with a dash dot slash hello and then program's name basically. And here in this case, please replace CC with G++ or Clang++. I just used CC as a placeholder here, so please use your G++, so GCC, GCC's C++ compiler, and Clang++ is Clang's C++ compiler. All right, I hope that still makes sense to people at somehow. Let me tell you about some useful compiler flags, especially as a beginner, and I mean, there's no reason not to, even as a professional senior C++ expert, do use compiler warnings. So use the additional compiler flags dash w all in order to tell your compiler, hey compiler, please tell me about warnings. If you find something fishy in my code that doesn't look quite right, please warn me about that. If you can, some things cannot be detected that easily, but please ask the compiler to warn you about certain things that don't look quite correct. If you are a bit more for pain, you can also, and I would advise you to do that at the very beginning, and not only at the beginning, but always, turn also on the extra warnings, such that the compiler will issue even more warnings if it detects some, not very good looking constructs or errors even. You can also use dash lowercase g to insert debugging symbols that will become important later on, so I won't get into detail here. And we will also have an entire lecture later on that will talk about compiler optimizations and static analysis, so we will talk about that later. I just want to mention it here as an important compiler flag. So there's this compiler flag dash uppercase o. And then you have an X, and X must be replaced by one number, 0 to 3. And it's basically, tells the compiler to optimize your code, because the modern C++ compilers are all optimizing compilers. They try to analyze your program in order to make it run faster and more memory efficient potentially. And if you use the compiler flag dash uppercase o 0, then it basically means, please don't use any compiler optimizations. And 3 basically means, use all the compiler optimizations in the world. Do whatever you can to make this program run fast. Again, we will talk about that in detail later on. We will have, in fact, a complete lecture on that. Dash lowercase o, we already used that to specify the output file that should be produced by the compiler. And then what's also very important is the std flag. So dash std equals, and then you specify the language standard to be used. And because here we are going to make use of modern C++ features from C++ 17 and potentially even 20, so also always use the compiler flag std C++ 17 or 20 even. So and the compiler command would then look like follows. So G++ or Clang++, whatever compiler you prefer, I don't mind. Enable all those warnings, set the language standard, specify your input file, which contains this piece of code here, specify an output file, and then press new line, to have your compiler execute that, and then it will compile your program into an executable. All right. So now let's get a bit more into details. Once again, we take our Hello World program and let's remind ourselves that C, C++, those compilers are actually language processing systems. Because on the last slide, we just directly compiled it down to a binary and done. But that's not what happens under the hood. Under the hood, you have something else. First of all, you have the hash directives. This hash include, this is an instruction for the preprocessor that transforms your program. And then the actual compiler starts compiling your program, your transform program to assembly. And include in this case is just text replacement. So this include directive means take the contents of this IO stream file. So somewhere on your system, in the compiler's installation targets, there is a file which goes by the name IO stream. And this file will contain some C++ code. And the hash include here will take the contents of that file, which resides on your file system, and will just copy it into that, into your file where you use that include here. That's how it works. And then you have this std colon colon, which is a namespace, and it allows you to access the cout variable. And cout is an output stream variable. It stands for character out, character output. Character because, yeah, you're printing characters to the output, basically. And this variable cout, that is in that IO stream header file. And this is also why you need to include the IO stream header to be able to access this variable here. That's the idea. And why do I have to use namespaces? This variable lives in the namespace std, and you can access that variable using std colon colon. Why do we need namespaces? To avoid collisions. For instance, if you have a large piece of software and you implement some stuff, and usually if you implement a larger piece of software, it's not only one person who implements and develops it, it's multiple persons. And let's say different people are implementing different components on of the software, and say you have no creativity and you name a function foo, right? And then a colleague also implements some completely other stuff, and he also implements a function which he calls by accident foo. And so you now have the same function foo, and that would be a collision, because the compiler sees now two different kind of implementations or versions of that foo function. And the compiler, of course, cannot make a choice here, right? The compiler does not know what foo to use, so it just complains and runs away. It can just take an arbitrary choice, of course, that would be stupid. and to help to sort out name collisions here, or variable names or function names, that's why we have namespaces. You can put things into different namespaces. I hope that makes sense to people. What else can we ask the compiler? We can also use the compiler option dash uppercase s to ask the compiler to show us the assembly code, right? We can use we can ask the compiler G++ or Clang++, give it the input file, specify the uppercase s option, and then specify our output file, which I just ended here in .as for assembly. And the compiler will then produce assembly code. And this is really low level one by one instructions that can actually be executed on the target machine. Those are instructions for the target architecture that I'm compiling that piece of software for. It's not yet executable code. It's just the instructions that should be executed one after another. And the compiler produces that assembly code if you ask it to, and if you don't ask it to, it just does under the hood. And this target assembly code is then finally, yeah, almost finally assembled to some machine code. And then once you linked it with some other necessary libraries or other code from your colleagues or whatnot, then you can produce machine code, which is executable. For this lecture here, most of the time we don't care, we just compile directly to binary and we ask the compiler, please take my file hello.cpp, produce an executable binary by the by the name of hello. I don't care what you do in between. I mean, you do the right things, and that would be a binary. If you open it in a hex editor, it really is then just ones and zeros, which can run on your CPU chip. Okay, hello world done. All right. Now let's discuss how to set up a development environment. So calling the compiler is wasteful, at least if you're working on larger projects, and I will also teach you a bit of the more practical sides of C++. So for this course, many times you probably get away with just compiling using the compiler in the command line and specifying the command yourself. But for larger projects or projects that comprise multiple source files, that is kind of wasteful. You don't want to do that every single time. And for that reason, there are build systems. So systems whose purpose is to build your software. Your software typically comprises multiple source files and maybe even some more libraries and other stuff. And build systems translate your entire software project into the desired target binaries. And some tools are make file, CMake, and there are dozens of other C++ build systems, of course. They help to organize a software source code. Yeah, I just mentioned that. And typically, those are all text files, or those are special files which only comprise text. And those text files describe rules that tell the compiler basically how to compile your program. Those rules are then read, identified, and executed on demand by associated tooling. And it's really flexible and powerful. Of course, if you're a beginner, those things, makefile and CMake files, are hard to write and even harder to write for complex tasks. But as always in life, this is basically how it works. You usually never really write those things on your own. You just start with a template that you copy from one of your more experienced colleagues, and then you are using his template and you are making improvements on his template or her. I will also provide you some example templates that you can use. I'll upload them on the web page, and I'll let you know once you can download them. And the great thing here is you see what's going on, right? So nothing is hidden under the carpet. You exactly can tell what happens in what order, and when the compiler is run, when the linker is run, and that's exactly what you need usually. On the other hand, you can have or can use integrated development environments, or in short IDEs. And those are kind of powerful editors which handles the project for you and also manages the corresponding source files for you. And handles compiler invocations. It's typically easier to use than makefile, CMake, and friends. It will also find syntax errors on the fly because it will run some analysis on your code in the background, and it will display and highlight if certain things don't work or don't match up, and it will then tell you. But the problem is, for more complex tasks, you are usually at some point lacking control, because it kind of hides complexity, right? I mean, that's its purpose. It should make your life easier, so it hides complexity. But that also means if you need to get the fine grain details right, if you want to do it exactly like that and pinpoint certain things, that can be quite hard. So what I recommend, and I'm using myself, is I use a combination. So I'm not going to use an IDE, so more like an improved text editor. That's usually what I'm using. And then I still use Make or CMake or whatnot as a build system. And I can only highly recommend doing so as well. Just as a quick example, such that you can have a look at what a makefile actually looks like and how it works, I have this example slide here. But don't worry, I do upload some examples which you can then just download and use, and yeah, you don't need to go through all the details. So let me briefly describe how makefile in general works. So in order to organize a program, you usually have one makefile per project. And makefile is really just a text file which you name makefile, exactly that spelling here. And then you edited it and you implement basically some rules or some targets. And you write those targets in a declarative rule or declarative style. And then there's a program which is called make, and make's job is to process that make file. And if you run make, it will then automatically detect what targets need to be executed, and then it will just execute your compiler to build your software. It's flexible, easy to use. It's hard to write sometimes. There are even books on make, so it's a bit more details. How you could do it is like follows. If you wish to create a new C++ project, a very small C++ project, you can create a directory, which for instance you name my project. And in that directory, you edit two files. One file goes by the name makefile, and that other file goes by the name hello.cpp. That hello.cpp, you just have that contents here, our small hello world program, and the makefile, you just edit this piece of makefile code, so to say, where you specify how that project is being compiled or has to be compiled. So here you have two targets, the target all, which basically says, yeah, here's my source file and please compile it with that line. I won't go into details here. And also you have a target clean, which just removes the final binary that is being compiled. That's how it could look like. And I will also offer you that as a download. Yeah, how about integrated development environments, IDE, and other editors? So I personally use VS Code, and now many colleagues of mine who also implement in C++ and develop C++ make fun of me. Haha, you use this childish editor, and that's not very good. And so to be honest, I couldn't care less about my editor. So as long as it allows me to edit some source files in a more or less efficient manner for me, at least, then I'm perfectly happy. So I really don't go into editor wars. I couldn't care any less, really. So use whatever suits you best. So I personally use this one. It's a compact editor, basically. It's pretty slim. It's available for Windows, Linux, or Mac. Or of course, if you're one of those become a hardcore C++ developer, you would probably use Vim or Emacs or whatnot. I don't care, to be honest. Use whatever feels best to you, depending on your programming language level and on the level of your experience. Yeah, that's all. Setting up a development environment. So I provided for download at our webpage here a virtual machine, and also here in that PDF, here's the link if you wish to take it from here. There's a readily set up virtual machine. The password is CPPP for C++ programming, and it contains an Ubuntu 20.04. And it ships with everything that's needed. So this virtual machine is Ubuntu. Yeah, it's a Linux-based system. It comes with a recent GCC installation. It comes with a recent Clang installation. So you have G++ and Clang++ as C++ compilers. It also comes with the VS Code editor. and everything else that you could ever need. So you can just use that if you want to. You could also, I mean, you again, you can use any setup that works for you. To get the best experience, I would recommend to use that setup. If you are a Linux user anyway, so that's even better, then you don't need to just use your ordinary system. There are also some online IDEs, there are editors online, just Google for C++ IDE or online IDE, and then you can also work with that. Again, I don't care, but the reason being why I provide that virtual machine is I can't provide tech support for over 200 students, right? That's impossible. I just can't solve all of your problems. So use that or whatever feels best to you, but don't complain if it doesn't work. And then one more remark on compiler errors before we actually start going into the lecture, really. Remark on compiler errors. If you write your Hello World program, maybe some people already spotted the error. But I don't know, I'm an early person, so I work best when I'm fresh, early in the morning. And when I'm unconcentrated, or not concentrated anymore, in the afternoon or evening, I write such a piece of software or such a piece of code, and I don't spot the error. So for me, this code looks perfectly fine, and for many of you viewers probably as well. Some guys probably already spotted the error. And if you then ask your compiler to compile that into a binary, the compiler will complain, because it actually is not only a warning, that's a hard error, and the compiler will stop, and the compiler will need you to fix that before it can compile it. Because, first of all, when you receive compiler errors, that's the normal thing. So, especially at the beginning, you will write code and your compiler will complain, because it will say, yeah, your code is rubbish, it doesn't work, here's an error, please fix it, otherwise I can't compile it. That's the ordinary case. Don't panic and read the error messages in order to figure out what's going on and in order to be able to fix it. So what happened here is, the compiler tells you error, use of undeclared identifier cout. Did you mean stut colon colon cout? And oh yeah, I forgot the stut colon colon, the namespace here. Just then fix it. Just fix it, save the file again, compile again, and then hopefully eventually you will end up with your correct binary. So here again, the steps, errors are the default case. Don't panic, read the error messages. Google will help. So if you can't make sense of those error messages, you can also, of course, use Google or Stack Overflow, for instance, as a programming forum that can also be used. And eventually you will hopefully find the answer. Okay. That has been Hello World and also even the development environment and the setup. Now let's come to basic terms and concepts here. So built-in data types. What built-in data types can you use in the C++ programming language? you can of course have Boolean types. By the way, what is a type actually? Of course, your computer only understands sequences of ones and zeros. Of course, yeah. So, I mean, you only have sequences of ones and zeros. And what a type basically does is a type associates meaning with such a bit sequence. A type associates meaning with a bit sequence. And it tells you what are allowed operations on that data. And here for the primitive built-in data types, you can have, again, Boolean types. The type name would be bool, that is a keyword. And it can hold values like true or false. In fact, those are the only values that a bool can carry. So a bool can either be true or false. You have character types, which can hold individual characters, or you can also put numbers in them. It's just 8 bits in size, 1 byte. A character is 1 byte in C++. You have integer types, which you can use for storing numbers, whole numbers, positive and negative. You also have some modifiers in sizes and signedness. So you can have a signed integer. So the default, unless you say otherwise, int is always signed. So you can store negative and positive numbers in an integer. If you write down unsigned int, you can only write positive numbers and zero. You can only store that data in a given bit string. Then you can also have the size modifiers, short, long, long, long. You can have a long int, which would give you a bit more bits, basically, in which to store data. So you can look up on Wikipedia this nice table, which tells you what kind of value ranges you can put into each of those data types. So what value fits into a certain data type. And then, of course, you have floating point types. Real numbers in mathematics are important, also in computer science. Many applications require floating point numbers or number computations, and therefore you have float, double, long double as floating point data types. And by default, please use the double data type for floating point numbers, because the float data type is nowadays far too imprecise. And money is really, money is cheap. Yeah, money is cheap as well currently, but memory is quite cheap today. So we can work with double as standard to get a suitable amount of precision. Floating point is just too imprecise for nowadays applications. And if you don't have a good reason to do otherwise, for working with whole numbers, you can use the integer type int, right? Okay. So now we have those types with which associate meaning with a bit string, but how does the encoding work, at least on a high level? Let's have some example. So let's take the data type unsigned character, unsigned char. So that's 1 byte, and it's basically then 8 bits, of course. And because we use the keyword unsigned here, it can only store positive values, including zero. If you use unsigned, then we are using a dual number encoding. So let's say we have that bit string, that's 1 byte, hopefully 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. Yeah, that matches. What number does this encode here? So basically, you can just transform a binary number into a decimal number by interpreting what that actually means. And what does it mean? It's powers of 2, right? At the beginning, starting from the right-hand side, you have 1 times 2 to the power of 0. Then this bit basically encodes 1 times 2 to the power of 1. 0 times 2 to the power of 2, 0 times 2 to the power of 3. So those are all powers of 2. And 1 or 0 just basically is the value in that corresponding place, right? In the decimal system also. Like what is 10? Yeah, it's powers of 10. 0 times 10 to the power of 0. And then the 1 place is 1 times 10 to the power of 1. And so 10 in decimal gives you 10, for obvious reasons, right? And it's basically the same thing here. You can just work it all out and convert a binary dual encoded number or dual number encoding into a decimal. So in this bit string here would encode the number, the decimal value 179, exactly. You can also have a signed data, signed integer, signed character. If you use char, you are always getting a signed char by default, but you can also be explicit about it. And if you use signed or as default, a two's complement encoding is used. So what is a two's complement? Let's assume that is our bit string here. And the encoding works as follows. The 2's complement encoding works as follows. The highest bit, which is the highest power of 2, which would be the leftmost bit here, this encodes the sign. 1, of course, being negative, and 0 being or denoting a positive number. And the remaining bits, the lower 7 bits here, encode the value. So here, the sign bit is 1, that means we have a negative number. And that also means that we have to take the 2's complement. What is 2's complement? It's basically, we have to negate the remaining bits and add 1 to it. Let's do that. Here's our original 7 remaining 7 bits. We take the complement, that is we flip a 0 to a 1, a 1 to a 0. And then we add 1 to it. So the right hand, the lowest bit here, yeah, we add a 1 to. That is our result. And then we do our powers of 2 thingy, like from the last slide, and we end up with, oh yeah, this value encodes 77. And because the leftmost bit has been a 1, that means, oh, that is negative 77, right? That's how it's done. And why are we using 2's complement here? Because if you use that 2's complement encoding for signed integers, when you use that, then addition and subtraction are the same thing. And you can prove it, of course, but it's the same thing using 2's complement encoding. And yeah, the reason being, it's just more simpler to implement the hardware for only addition. Yeah, so you don't need to be concerned with how to implement the subtraction. It's the same thing here using 2's complement. Let's briefly have a look at floating point number encoding. How does that all work out? So I won't go into details. You can just look it up on Wikipedia, as I did here myself. So there are also formulas which tell you basically how you can encode floating point numbers in a bit string, in a bit sequence of bits. And those are the formulas for float, and this is for double here. So again, use double as a default. Float is usually far too imprecise for nowadays computations. And keep in mind the following. Floating point numbers are not distributed equidistant. So if you're working with integer types, then an integer type has a value. And this is, of course, the integer's precise value. Floating point numbers, of course, can only be, yeah, kind of as precise. So, and they're not distributed equidistant, meaning the larger your numbers, the larger the real numbers you try to store into in a floating point type, the larger the numbers, the more space do you have between two representations of the next real number, basically. And for smaller real numbers, it's getting better and better. But for the larger numbers, you basically have space in math. You have some real numbers which you cannot exactly store in memory. But what you can do store as a value in memory in a computer is the closest thing to the original real number from mathematics, right? I hope that makes still sense to people. So, but you can only store representations of the closest thing. Because why is that? I mean, a computer only has finite memory. And there are arbitrarily many real numbers. And you can only store such many in such a data type. Okay. That should be it about representation as a brief overview. That's basically how it works. So let's talk about comments. I already mentioned that earlier in today's lecture. So comments tell you and your colleagues what your code does, or at least what it is supposed to do. And yeah, you should make use of comments in order to document what your program is all about, because sometimes your code can get really complex. And then it's especially, say you are on vacation for 2 weeks, and after 2 weeks you come back to your office and you have a look at your code because you still need to add some more feature or need to improve it a bit, then it can really happen that you think, oh, all right, how does it work? And you have no clue, because the context switch has been so long, you will forget. And this is why you need comments. There are different kinds of comments in C++. I would recommend you to use single line comments only. And if you need to have a comment that spans multiple lines, always just introduce every line with that //. That is my advice. So only use that, use those single line comments. You could theoretically also have multi-line comments, which you introduce with /*, and */. That's how to close them. And everything in between is a comment. And again, comments are completely ignored by the compiler. And that is a mistake when you use the multi-line comment begin, multi-comment line end. That would be invalid. So once you have that closing kind of pattern here, that */, then the comment is over and you cannot just continue. Then the compiler would throw an error and the compiler would say, hey, I don't understand those lines here. So, and that's one of the reasons why you should always only use single line comments. And if you have comments spanning multiple lines, introduce every line with a */. Exactly. So those are comments. Let's talk about literals now. Literals are values, plain values. They hold a value from mathematics, typically. So what are literals and how do they work? Because at some point we need literals in order to specify computations, right? That is the whole point here being. So if you edit your text file, your source file, and if you write the number 100 in the source code, that means the literal 100, and it is interpreted as an integer. And by default, C++ is smart enough. So if you just write a number like 100 in your source code, it will be interpreted as a decimal number. So decimal 100. So that is an integer decimal with the value of 100. Then that would also be an integer decimal with the value 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. So what is it even? 123,456. 5L. Here we can have some literals, literals basically, so some kind of suffix to specify if it's not just a plain integer. Here 5L basically, uppercase L, it's a long encoded in decimal. 123U, lowercase u, is unsigned int, decimal. UL is 777 as a decimal value, as a data type is unsigned long. That's basically the idea how to read it. What do we have here? Minus O to uppercase O, and this is a zero. Sorry, that first thingy here is a zero. That second one is really an O. And this is an octal encoding. So in the octal system, an integer octal, an octal system. This is how you encode hexadecimal values. So when you have a number which you prefix with 0x, and then what follows is interpreted as an integer hexadecimal in this case. That would be an integer in hexadecimal and it would be an unsigned long data type. That's it. Let's leave it be for integers. With those examples, then you of course can also have character literals. So character A, you just do the single ticks basically and have your character. For instance here, uppercase A is character A. Star or asterisk symbol is symbol star asterisk. Backslash zero is basically indicates the end of a string. That's the end of a string character. So in characters, we sometimes do have some special characters like the new line character. How to represent the new line character? And those special characters are introduced with a backslash to denote that this is a special character. Because how otherwise would you encode a line break, right? If you just use lowercase n, yeah, no, that would be lowercase n, right? So those special meaning characters are introduced with a backslash. So backslash n would be the new line character. Backslash t is the tabulator character. Backslash apostrophe is basically the apostrophe. Backslash backslash, of course, I mean, if you wish to represent the backslash, now you are into trouble because you're already using that for escaping special characters, and which is why you also have to escape the backslash with a backslash. I hope that makes still sense to people. And there are not only character literals in C and C++, but there are also string literals. So a string literal would be introduced in quotation marks. So you have quotation marks and then you just have some text, which is a string literal or represents a string literal. Strings are a bit special in C and C++, and I don't even tell you about how strings are represented in C. We will learn more on strings and how to use strings in a sane way in C++ later on. So more on strings and how to represent them later on. Floating point literals. Let's talk about floating point numbers. So minus 9.876, that's a double. And again, default is double for floating point numbers. Default, unless you tell otherwise, the compiler is integer for whole numbers. So then you can also specify a floating point number like that. So 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. And this E, basically uppercase E, or could also be a lowercase E, this specifies the exponent. And what that means is basically this number here times 10 to the minus 7. That's basically just scientific floating point notation here. And it's also double. What else do we have? This is 1 exponent 12. That means 1 times 10 to the power of 12. It's also double. You can also omit the leading zero. So 0.0 or 1 is just a double number or literal. Here, if you really wish to use a float, although you shouldn't, you can use an F here to indicate, yeah, that should be interpreted as a float. If you wish to use a long double, you can use that L here to make it long double, literal. And now that you have literals, and now that we have, or you have data types, we can now go ahead in C++ and define variables. And variables will be quite useful later on in the next lecture to actually specify computations. So for that, we need variables, of course. So what you could do is you could have your main code, and what now follows on the left-hand side can be just written inside of main, and the compiler will happily read and compile that, unless you write some garbage. So what is a variable? A variable has a type, a variable has a name, and optional, a variable also has an initial value. So how could that look like? Or how does it look like for the built-in primitive data types? You can have an integer variable by the name of I, which you initially assign to 42. So this first statement here, it's called statement. You define a variable named I of type integer with value 42. And then you can use that variable I in your program after you've defined it, of course. And wherever I is used, its value is being used, which is currently stored in that variable, which here in this case would be 42. More on that later on. You can also define a variable by the name of j of type integer, and here you just don't specify an initial value. That's also okay. Here are some other ways. Here are some double numbers, double variables, floating variables that you initialize. Here are some strings again in old C style representation. Please don't do that. We will talk in one of the very next lectures on how to use strings in C++. So I won't even go into details on that one. You can also, of course, create an integer variable by the name of ui, which you say, yeah, that should be an unsigned integer, and you initialize it with 123. There is one problem, however. What you should not do is the following. What you should not do is the last statement here, because what do you specify? You have a variable of name by the name of huge, and you say, yeah, that should be an unsigned integer. Okay, unsigned integer. And remember, unsigned integer means dual number encoding, no negative numbers, right? We already discussed it. And then the literal on the right hand side is minus 13. And you probably already know where this is going. Minus 13 is a literal which the compiler interprets as integer, signed integer. So, and because it's a negative signed integer literal, the first bit will be a 1 because it's negative, right? And now you initialize that unsigned int variable huge with that negative integer. You obtain a huge number because the variable huge will not cannot represent minus 13, right? It cannot represent negative numbers at all. And what you will end up with is the variable huge will contain a huge integer because the highest power of 2 is a 1, which in that unsigned dual encoding just means, yeah, huge number, right? So please don't do that. That is a mistake here, and that's not very good. And for most of the times, unless you really know what you're doing, please do initialize your variables. Because what can happen in C, C++ quite easily is that you specify some value, you declare a variable. So that would be called, if you don't specify an initial value, that would be called you declare a variable. And if you specify an optional initial value, that would be called you define a variable. But if you only declare a variable without initializing that, and if you then use that variable, it can contain arbitrary rubbish, right? So, I mean, if you just use an uninitialized variable, that's undefined behavior right away. So be very careful, and that is why you should always initialize your variables unless you really know what you are doing. So, and the thing is, in programming languages like Java, okay, Java is a bit of a specific case because it is a hosted language. It runs on a virtual machine rather than your actual CPU chip directly. That means if you do stupid things in Java, the Java compiler will tell you, and if the Java compiler can't tell you, the Java virtual machine will detect issues with your code while executing it. And if you do some mistakes, Java will tell you, for instance, yeah, here array index out of bound exception in line number so and so. And that's then really easy to fix those kind of bugs. If you do stupid things in C++, you don't have that, because C++ programs are typically directly compiled to binaries, executable binaries, which run on your chip processor, processor chip directly. This happens here. Segmentation fault. Great. So basically it leaves you with no information other than, yeah, there's a bug in your program. Go fix it. there's of course a bit more that you can do, but it's far too much to explain here for a beginner's course, so I don't tell you how to fix that, at least not in this very first lecture. Maybe later on I'll give you some hints. But anyhow, the case being here that in C++, don't do stupid things. So especially don't do those things here. Otherwise, yeah, you will just segfault your program, and then the operating system will just kill your program. This is dangerous. That would be actually an integer overflow. And C++ is famous for its so-called undefined behavior. So that is a thing in C++, undefined behavior. What does it mean? The C++ standard allows undefined behavior in some situations. And you might think, yeah, what does it mean? I mean, if I write a program, I do wish to have my program compute results correctly, right? And this is also the case. If your program is correct, it will most of the time compute the correct results, right? But undefined behavior means something else. Undefined behavior means that if you do something which you are not allowed to do, then anything can happen. The behavior is not defined that should happen, and in that case, which you were not allowed to do, but you did anyways. for instance, that would be also a small example here. So if you have an integer I, you declare an integer, but you don't give it an initial value. And if you then just use that uninitialized variable, that value in the computation, that is also undefined behavior. And yeah, again, what do I mean by anything can happen? So it depends on your compiler's implementation. And now you can, of course, ask the valid question, why would anyone ever allow for undefined behavior? I mean, that seems stupid, right? I mean, you can blow up your leg by using such a silly mistake here by forgetting to initialize correctly. So what's the reason being? The reason being is compilers can produce faster machine code when assuming, or when they can assume, that certain things cannot happen. So the reason being is performance. So if you can assume that some things are not allowed to happen, then compilers can produce faster machine code, which is ultimately the goal of almost any C++ program, right? Because why are you using C++? You want to have fast software. And because C++ gives you a huge amount of control over the complete machine, you have all the possibilities, all the tools for writing fast and efficient programs. And this is also one thingy here that goes into in that direction. So what else? When we talk about variables in modern C++, we also have to mention the auto keyword. And auto allows for automatic type deduction. That basically means you can declare a variable of type auto, and the compiler will find the correct type itself. My recommendation is always be verbose. So if it's an int, just specify it's an int. I mean, that's at least my approach to things. And if the type name gets too long, or the type name is obvious, then you can use auto to have the compiler figuring it out for itself. And by using auto, for instance, you can and the other modern C++ features that have been introduced with C++ 11 and ongoing. In C++ 98, so you don't have to understand what this code does exactly, you will learn soon. In C++ 98, you had to write such terrible code. I mean, it looks messy, and does it look very good, right? I guess we can agree all on that. And in modern C++, you could just write that one here. And I mean, it looks much nicer, much simpler, at least. That's my feeling here. So how does it work? It's, I mean, type deduction. So if, what's the type of the variable x in the case in the above? So 13L, and x would then just be of type long. Right, because auto basically means here compiler, please figure out for yourself. And then if you initialize a variable with a integer long, with a long literal, then of course the auto will be deduced to a long. And here in the second case, it would be a double. So x would be of type double. And yeah, to just make a point and telling you how powerful C++ is. In C++, there are approximately like 50 ways to initialize a simple integer. I just show you a very few. So you can initialize an integer like that. You can use this syntax. You can use that brace initialization. You can use that initializer list initialization. You can use auto, of course, because auto will then also be deduced to an integer here because you initialize with integer literals. And all that good stuff. So it's like crazy, but just making a point. I just let you have a look at this meme for a second. Making a point, it can get complicated quite quickly, but let's try to stick to what keeps us sane, right? But that's just C++ being C++. Yeah, C++ is very flexible, it says here. Mm-hmm. All right, then we are almost done. We only need to talk about IO streams for your first homework, for your first exercise sheet here. what are I/O streams? I/O first of all stands for input output, and streams are some resources of your systems where you can get data from or you can write data to. And why we need to talk about I/O streams is allowing you to be able to solve the first exercise sheet, where you should write a small program which reads in some data from the command line, and then it prints also some data again back to the command line. So in order to use I/O streams, you need to include the header file I/O stream using the preprocessor directive hash include. IOStream is a header file which is part of the STL, and its contents live in the namespace std, in the standard namespace, which is why you, for instance, the cout output stream variable, you had to prefix with std colon colon to indicate, yeah, this variable lives in namespace standard, and exactly. the important variables here are cin, for character input stream, cout, character output stream, cerr, character error stream, and clog, which nobody really uses, is the character log stream, basically for general information. And then we already have operator overloading going on. We will learn about operator overloading in detail later on. But the shift left and shift right operators have been defined for, or on, I should rather say, on the stream variables, such that you can use the syntax. You have some data and you use the left shift or right shift, depending on what kind of stuff you're trying to achieve. And you can just shove the data into the stream or read data from the stream. That's just syntax, basically. So what could you do? You could write such small example program, where you have a small main function, you include the IOStream header file, which lets access you the output streams and input streams. And then, for instance, you can have an integer I, which you initialize to zero. Then you can print to the command line, enter an integer, that's the string, just shows up on the command line. Then you can read an integer from the input stream, and so the program basically sits there waiting until a user types an integer number into the command line and presses enter. And then it reads in the data from the input stream, it reads it into the integer variable I. And afterwards it just prints I's value again with help of that nice message. And once it's done all that, it returns 0 to the operating system, indicating, yes, this program run fine, everything all right. So now that would be it for today. Let's briefly recap. What did we talk about today? So I presented to you the course outline. We talked about what C++ is. We talked about briefly the history of C++, how it evolved from BCPL, if you want to be honest. Compilers. We talked about compilers. What's a compiler's job? How do they work? And what are compiler implementations that can be used in practice? We wrote a Hello World program. We talked about built-in types, information encoding, how the types associate meaning with a bit string. And we talked about variables and at the very end, IO streams. So funny me again, any questions? And of course you can't ask questions as of now, but what you do can is you can use the forum on Panda. So please use the Q&A in Panda if you have any questions. And then your colleagues, of course, are also allowed to answer if they know better. Or if they know the answer at least, and I will also answer everything else when I have the time to answer that. And I'll try to do my best to answer quickly. What next? Now let's do one more thing. Let's actually write a Hello World program using my editor of choice, which I'm using from day to day, Visual Studio Code. And then I'll show you how to get a C++ job and what kind of money they are paying and all the good stuff that might be interesting to you. So let's do that. Let's open my editor here. And let me switch to my editor here. Haha, it worked out well. Okay, so what do we have here? That's our editor, or at least my editor, VS Code. I am located in that directory here, so print current working directory, pwd, gives us the current working directory, so that's the directory I'm currently in, right? That's the path here to the directory. And if I type ls for list all the files in that directory, it shows me, empty. So, and you can also see here in an overview, this directory is currently empty. So since this directory is empty, maybe let's create a new file, right? And let's call that file hello, and let's make it a C++ source file. So let's name it hello.cpp. And now we can edit C++ code in here and eventually hopefully compile it. That makes sense to people. So in order to be able to print hello world to the command line, we of course, as explained multiple times now, we need the header file iostream. We will learn why it is called a header file, by the way, later on in this course, so don't worry, we'll get into all the details here. And then we need a main function in main, no arguments, no command line arguments. We will also learn what command line arguments are used for later on, so no worries. And let's also return 0 at the very end and say to the operating system basically, fine, no problems, everything worked well. And what we now need to do in order to print something to the command line is we need to use the character output stream, which we can find in the namespace std. We use the overloaded left shift operator. And then we can just type in a string literal, hello world, and backslash n to have a nice new line at the very end. It just reads nice on the command line. So let me remove all those things. And now, if we list our directory's contents again, we now have edited the file hello.cpp with the following contents. The file is saved, and we can now compile it. So clang plus plus, set the standard to C++17. Enable all warnings, enable some extra warnings, and then specify the source file and specify an output file. All right, and if the compiler does not complain, that usually means, okay, the compiler could do its job, so everything worked fine. And now let's list, first of all, here to the left, we already see, oh, we got a new file. And this is, in fact, the resulting binary executable. And if we list our directory's contents again using the ls command here, we now see we have that additional file hello, and it's even highlighted in green. And at least on my systems, files highlighted in green mean that this file is an executable file. So what I can do now is I can use dot slash hello, and I can run it. And surprise, surprise, it prints hello world to the command line as we told it to in the program code here. So that's pretty much how you implement a first hello world program. Okay, so that would be almost it. Now let me briefly show you how to find a C++ job. At least one way. I mean, there are also platforms like LinkedIn and Xing and whatnot, and I just use it to prove a point here. So let's go to a programming forum, which is called Stack Overflow. You will learn about that forum a lot during this course, because probably it's a great source of finding answers to your programming questions. And yeah, maybe let's accept cookies here. And let's find a job. Jobs. And now my internet is slow, my internet connection. Okay. Find a job. And let's find a job. So C++, maybe what is our thing? C++ programming, maybe. Right, and yeah, I mean, now you end up with a list of jobs. Some say what they are paying, willing to pay, other companies don't. It's a bit of a mixed bag here, so you have to look for yourself. But what do we have? Embedded C++ research engineer, that sounds pretty interesting. C++ software engineer, senior embedded C++ engineer, up to 80,000 a year, 80,000 euros a year. That's quite good money already. Oh, here, now we are getting somewhere. Automated trading systems. That's always a good source of money. So here, in this case, up to 110,000 euros a year. And those numbers can get even higher. I recently saw a job offer for also some automated trading company, which offered like, but you did need some experience, some more experience. It was like 10 years of C++ development. But what they did offer was like 400,000 euros a year, which is quite good money, I would say. And it was also in the Netherlands. So that would also be interesting to me, actually. Yeah, but what's an automated trading system, by the way? Maybe just briefly on that one. C++ can be used to write fast software, and an automated trading system is some companies build a mathematical model and implement that in C++, make that model as fast as possible. And what do? You read in all the stock market data, you read in all the data from the internet and from all the different resources, you put it into your model. You run that model as fast as possible to predict the future in short term, of course, but then it allows you which stocks to sell and which stocks to buy. And if you are faster, or if you're fast enough, or faster as your competitors, you can make money from nothing basically, besides running and implementing fast software. from a moral standpoint of view, yeah, that needs to be decided for oneself. I don't know. I won't comment on that one. But anyhow, good jobs in terms of yeah, being a C++ software developer. We can also, I mean, crank up the compensation here a bit. Let's write in some good numbers here. And I mean, you can play the game for yourself. Here we are getting some better numbers even. Oh, here it's even better. So I mean, you can look it up for yourself, but as a C++ programmer, you most likely end up having a well-paid job, basically. That's my point here. And I would say I will leave it there because we are a bit over time here. So that would be all for today. Thank you very much. We won't have an exercise class today. Today I already uploaded the exercise sheet, which you can work on, and you have to hand it in next Friday, which would be Friday 23rd. And yeah, then next Friday, next week on Friday, we will have our first exercise session as a live stream on Twitch at 16 in the afternoon, where I will present the solutions to the very first sheet. All right, then thank you very much and have a nice week. Bye bye.